it represents the total amount of energy. From a chemistry perspective, that means it is the energy stored in the bonds plus the kinetic energy motion. Now, for a lot of cases, the energy stored in the bonds is by far greater than the energy of the motion of the particles. So if we think about solids and liquids, they're not really moving very much, are they? So basically all of their energy is stored in the bonds. And we know as well that breaking bonds Now the total energy is really hard to measure because working out what the actual kinetic energy of the particles are is going to be a difficult calculation. So by and large we don't actually calculate H by itself. We don't find the total energy of the system. What we actually find is the change in energy. Delta H. Okay, so grid letter delta. This represents the change in input. Which is much easier to measure. And the way we're going to be finding this often is by changing temperature. Because we know that represents either needed or released by the system. And so what this leads us to is if we're thinking about being able to relate this to temperature, we need to know for a particular reaction whether it is exothermic. Now, I reckon in high school you've probably heard these terms. We didn't talk about them at all on this side. Do we all know what exothermic means? So, an exothermic reaction does what?
Produces heat.
So what do you think an endothermic reaction is?
Why
is it cooler? Now, if we're thinking about this change in entropy being related to temperature and an exothermic reaction producing heat, where it's really exits the system. So think about other ways of getting this clear now, yes. But the important thing to remember, no matter how you remember it, could be memorizing it, just as a word learning, but the delta H value is always negative for an exothermic reaction. And this will become clearer to you again as we move on. And so, I think to and then for an endothermic reaction, we're changing the process. Now the reason why it's arranged this way is if we think about our energy diagram. Energy on our y-axis, and so this is increasing up. Then for an exothermic reaction, our reactants start at a higher energy level and they end up, our products end up at a lower energy level. And this is the amount of energy that has been released through the chemical reaction. And so that is why the delta H is negative. Because we've started higher and then we've ended lower. So delta H. Higher energy level. We've had to add energy, and that's why our delta H value is positive. This goes on with endothermic reactions. It takes a little bit of thinking about, because we're probably less familiar with them. Exothermic reactions. So if we think about this as representing a generic exothermic and a generic endothermic reaction, we can see that we can calculate the change in entropy because that is equal to the sum of the entropy of the products. Subtract the sum of the entropy of the reactants. And so if we look at our graph here, we think, well, whatever our value was here, say 2000, not going to worry about it, you know, giving you some numbers to make this clear for our calculations. If that was 2,000 for our products and 3,500 for our reactants, and our delta H for this reaction would equal 2,000 subtract 3,500, which is then -1,500. Does that make sense? Well, we would be measuring it in joules or kilojoules, so let's just say it's joules. That tells me that this reaction releases 1,500 joules of energy. Yeah? The same if we looked at our endothermic reaction, it's the same then, but our delta H will equal our products here, which is going to be 3,000, subtract 2,000. Which would be 1,000 joules, but it's a positive number there. So this is the amount of energy that is required to be added to the system. I've got some examples of exothermic and endothermic reactions. So petrol plus oxygen. So it just comes up so water. But it also produces energy. Plus oxygen. So 202, Osage 2 Road, Lost Inn. Now, because we put the Plus Energy on there as a product, that's telling me that it's exothermic. Because that's where the energy is, it's on the right-hand side. And I can then say that my delta H value will be negative. Sodium hydroxide plus water. So NaOH solid plus H2O gives us NaOH. Yes. This is actually also exothermic. So that means I've got energy produced as a product. Why? Also exothermic, therefore the delta H value is negative. The third example there is burning ethanol, and methanol, and again, it is also exothermic. If you turn the page, the example of an endothermic reaction is photosynthesis. So this is what plants do in the leaves, chlorophyll in the leaves. In this case, we have carbon dioxide plus water plus energy. The chlorophyll then helps us produce glucose and oxygen. Because the energy is on the left hand side, the energy coming from the sun, this must be therefore endothermic. You can think of it as needing energy as a reactant for this to actually take place. Too much at the moment, so we'll get onto numbers later, but we're just thinking about it in terms of what's happening. You can have a little bit of a read through about the collision theory, and that's where I'll start on Monday next week. You all know that we're not here Friday.